So hi guys, today our speaker is Professor Alok Ladha from Chennai Mathematical Institute. He's going to speak about finding polytopes from positive geometry of the S matrix. He's for the long time working on this issue with students, and he is going to share his experience and point of view regarding this topic. This is 87th talk in the series of QSTM Zoominar. And thank you, Alok, for agreeing to give this talk. And we are welcoming you. Now you can start from your.
Okay, thanks, Anton. Yeah, so thanks a lot for inviting me here to give a seminar. And I really have tried to make a talk keeping students in mind. So please like interrupt me as much as possible and ask questions. I really don't have any end goal to reach in the talk. So yeah, it can be, it will be better if it's more like more question oriented in that. So this is the title. Basically, I'm going to talk about some new development which has happened in the understanding of the generic general S-matrix program of quantum theory, which goes under the name of, sometimes it's called the program of positive geometry, and sometimes it's called the program of amplitude hindrance. These words are something you will understand once in, during the talk. Okay, so let me start with some motivation that, you know, as I think most of us, I mean, all of us probably know that S matrix is, you know, the fundamental object in quantum field theory. And then there's something we learn, of course, I mean, it's obviously very fundamental. We learn about it in our very first quantum field theory course, where, you know, we learn how to compute probability amplitude for, say, a scattering in QED, for example, when you have some incoming state with total momentum capital P in, scattering into some outgoing state with total momentum capital P out. And, you know, what we really compute are these S matrix elements, which is a, you know, matrix element of this. S matrix is an operator, so we compute this matrix element. And of course, because if you're studying quantum theory in Cauchy space, then there is always a total momentum conservation because of translation invariance. So we have this, you know, delta function piece hanging around, which is universal, so we don't really worry about it. And then the stuff that multiplies it is what is called the scattering amplitude, which I denote here as 50. And so of course, they, you know, as far as quantum theory in Cauchy space is concerned, they, you know, this script A contains complete information about the S matrix, in particular also about quantum field theory. When we learn this, how to compute this object in our QFT course, you know, there is a very standard approach we follow, which is to start from a Lagrangian, and then we compute sort of construct a perturbative expansion in terms of Feynman diagram. So that's the usual approach. So for example, if you want to compute, say, n to the m particle scattering in QED, then you sum over all possible Feynman diagrams that you have, which are such that you have n particles coming in and m particles going out, and then you compute. But this approach, it has been realized for a long time now.
Sorry to interrupt. So this is a perturbative procedure. So is there any procedure exist in literature if there is no perturbation, like non-perturbative scattering matrix or something like that?
Well, I mean, that's actually extremely good question. So I think that we know in two dimensions, in two dimensions, how to compute, for example, S matrices for when we don't have perturbative expansion. But in four dimensions, as far as I understand, there is no systematic approach. There are, of course, we understand how to include non-perturbative corrections, you know, instanton corrections, and there are these new developments in what is called Jensen technique, etc., to include non-perturbative corrections. But if you don't, it's a very good question. I mean, I think if you just take a theory on a lattice and I want to compute the S matrix, is there a systematic approach? Except doing lattice computation, I don't know any other, like a formal approach. It's a really good question. Is that fine, Sandham?
Yeah, so I specifically asked this question because last year there was a paper by Vladimir Rosenhaus regarding this chaotic S matrix, where he he didn't compute it anything, but he actually tell about how to deal with that. So that's why I was curious to understand that how
That's a very good point. So So I should also say that, you know, sometimes what happens is that since in the context of black holes especially, is that, you know, many times these perturbative corrections can be resummed so that the full result is non-perturbative, but you know, it comes via perturbative correction. So one classical example is iconal scattering, where you take two particles scattering at large impact parameter, and there what happens is that you can sum over all loops which dominate in this process where you have large impact parameter, and then this resum result is obviously a non-perturbative result because you have sum over all loop expansion. And I don't know, I have not really looked at Vladimir's paper carefully. I don't know if it's a chaotic estimate. If you get it via some resummed technique, or is it just defined as a non-quantitative object? That is, But I must say that it is true that we, even though we started perturbative, I mean, there are occasions like this iconal scattering where the final answer is not perturbative.
Okay. Another question. This whole setup is basically based on the fact that the quantum system or field theory you are talking about, it's basically not interacting with the environment or very closed kind of adiabatic type. If there is some interaction, means I am talking about like open quantum system. So is there is any extension of this kind of calculation?
No, actually, you know, as you will see in the talk, this approach so far only generates amplitudes for theories which are regulated. So they only generate unitary amplitudes. So I don't think any work so far, everything I talk about here, I don't think there's any direct way we can apply it to this particular system. Not that I know of directly. Because you know the whole thing is that what we get, as you will see, what we will get out of this, we will not really be computing amplitude. You know, strictly speaking, we will be computing some volumes of some objects or something, but they give us something which is just unitary. Like they won't give us anything which is not not unitary. So again, I don't know. I mean, these are all really good questions, but they are all open questions. I don't know if there is any answer. At least I have no answer at all.
Maybe I'm not disturbing you a lot for asking a lot of questions.
No, please ask. I think it's better to ask more questions. As I said, you know, I don't have any end goal. Please, yeah. I think this is much better.
Okay, thanks.
Yeah. So, but you know, this approach of even if when we are doing, as we discussed, and when we do perturbative expansion, this approach of using Feynman diagram starting from Lagrangian becomes messy very, quite, very fast. And you know, easiest way to see this is look at just, you know, three level amplitudes of gluons in Yang-Wien's case. So here, if you compute say two incoming gluons going into two outgoing gluons, then you need four Feynman diagrams. But you just go to two incoming gluons going to say eight outgoing gluons, then you require over a million Feynman diagrams. And you know, go higher, it becomes completely uncontrollable. And this is not even loop corrections, right? So just the idea that the number of diagrams proliferate kind of tell you that, is this, you know, it makes you worry, right? That, you know, is this the best one can do? And okay, you may think that, you know, maybe that's what we can do, because you know, in the end we start the Lagrangian and we compute whatever we can compute. But it turns out that it became clear in, you know, around like I think 86 or 87 that this really Feynman diagrams really obscure the simplicity, and in many cases, as we will understand later, symmetry is what we call symmetry of scattering. And the first example that you saw that maybe Feynman diagrams are a bit deceptive in computing asymmetric in, you know, in all cases, is what was known as what is called a Park-Taylor formula. Here these authors, they conjectured a formula which was proved later, is that if you take again in pure Yang-Wien, you get scattering of gluons, but again you are only interested in the three level amplitude. And you have said two gluons, which are positive helicity, and they scatter into say n minus two gluons, which are negative helicity. Then it comes out that this amplitude, even though it could be now n could be anything, so this amplitude could have some over trillion Feynman diagrams. But in the end, it turned out that one could write this in a very compact form in terms of some abstract bracket object. So for our talk, it's not important what this bracket notation is. It's just that it kind of packs information about polarization and momenta of the external particles. I mean, these are gluons, so they have some polarization or helicity. So that all information is packed in this, this bracket type notation. But the important point is it's like one term. So if you do Feynman diagram, you would have trillion diagrams, and somehow it looks like when you sum them, so many cancellation happen. that if you write the final answer in terms of these F variables, these bracket variables, then you get a compact result. So clearly, this is telling you that maybe Feynman diagram is a wrong way to, you know, compute your answer. There must be some better and a different way.
So this was like a Alok, sign is the incoming and minus is the outgoing.
No, sorry. Yeah, this here the plus and minus are the helicity. So here I have been because this answer is agnostic towards which are in and which are outgoing. So I did not bother to specify. So what is important is that you have two particles which are positive helicity and n minus two which are negative.
Okay.
Any of them can be incoming and any of them can be outgoing. So this was the first kind of evidence that, you know, maybe this is not the right part. Are always the right approach to compute going from Lagrangian to Feynman diagram. So in fact, you know, as we can see, they kind of they tell you that amplitudes are a little bit elusive in the sense that we thought we can compute them for Feynman diagram, but then there must be so many cancellations, you know, trillion diagrams cancel to give you one term. And you know, it kind of tells you that even in perturbative three-level amplitude, there are new structures which are emerging. Like you are seeing this bracket variable, you see how compact the expression. And this is why amplitude is a field is always exciting, because you know it turns out that even perturbative amplitude continue to show us new structures which are, you know, very very subtle. So hopefully some of them I will be able to explain. So there's another angle you could take, you know, in hindsight, why Feynman diagram is not the best, probably the best way to evaluate amplitude always, and that is, you know, because what amplitudes are, so they are on-shell quantities, as we know, in the sense that they are just physical. And of course, so they are gauge invariant. But when we do, you know, Feynman diagrams based on Lagrangian methods, etc., we really start with fields, the gauge potentials, etc. So we are kind of forced to consider, because we have these local Lagrangians like fields, so we are forced to consider things like gauge redundancy. Like there is really no escape when you compute the Feynman diagrams of QCD. We have to do gauge fixing, etc. And so it could be that, you know, when they say that, you know, all the unnecessary complications that came is because, you know, we are working with things which are redundant, like gauge potential. Things like that, whereas the final answer, you know, is the gauge invariant, which should not depend on this extra data. But this is all about, you know, question of efficiency. Okay, can we compute S matrix efficiently using Feynman diagrams? But we can also ask, you know, how much do these techniques tell us about definition of the S matrix per se? I mean, you know, if someone asks us that S matrix is a function of external momentum, what class of functions are always what we can call S matrix of a local quantum state? So if you want to answer this question, of course, we need to first understand what defines an S matrix of quantum state. You know, not like example by example, like QED and QCD, et cetera, but just generically, what are the postulates which give us a definition of S matrix? And so just before giving you the postulates, I just said some terminology. So of course, as I think you all know that these amplitudes are Lorentz invariant, so they are only functions of scalar products of the external momentum. They can't depend on score vectors because they're scalars. And so, for example, okay, for Q2 scattering, this means that, you know, convenient variables to express a scattering amplitude are what are called Mandelstam variables. So, you have two particles P1, P2 with momentum P1, P2, and they scatter into P3, P4. Then, you know, as you know, you can see that there are these three Mandelstam invariants, and any amplitude is a function of these invariants. In fact, because of momentum conservation, it turns out that these are not even independent and they satisfy this constraint that I have written below, where I have not assumed anything about the masses. So you can have four particles with completely different masses, and you can easily check using momentum conservation that they always satisfy this constraint, where this term is just m1 squared plus m2 squared plus m3 squared. And so, you know, in that sense, you know, usually when you see some literature, you see that the Q2 scattering amplitude is written as a function of just two of these variables, like S and T or T and U or S and U. That's just because these variables satisfy. Once you take this minus S matrix for you, the question that you have in mind is that, okay, I have Q2 scattering, I want to look at classify all possible functions of S and T, which are S matrix of some quantum system. Like that's to answer that question, you have to understand what are the conditions a function of S and T have to satisfy. And so these are the four postulates that people, kind of came up with in 60s, and this went under the name of analytic S matrix program. So the four postulates, some of them are kind of obvious. So of course, we want our S matrix to be unitary, unless of course we are looking at systems that Samson mentioned, like open quantum systems. But for the purpose of this talk, we just worry about closed quantum theory. Then since we are here in Minkowski space, we need Poincare invariance. And there is one symmetry which has been, you know, which was observed via computation of Feynman diagram, for example, and it kind of became a postulate because one did not know any example which did not satisfy this magic symmetry, which was called crossing symmetry, where the idea is that, you know, if you take amplitude in the S channel, which means that if I first P1 and P2 collide, and I ask what is the amplitude for the outgoing momentum to be P3, P4, if I know that amplitude, then I can use that to compute the amplitude where P1 and P3 collide, then I want to ask what is the amplitude for outgoing first momentum. So this was a postulate because it was not proved. In fact, only last year, you know, in the scalar quantum theory case, a proof, really clean proof of this has become available. And then there was a postulate which is in some sense hardest to understand because something that we don't discuss in the theory courses, but it's also the most sort of crucial to understand. And that is what is called the maximal analyticity. So it takes a little bit to kind of explain it in detail, but in essence, I mean, you can understand the basic idea behind this postulate easily. It tells you that if you think of this S and T as not real variables, like of course in a scattering, real physical scattering, these are S is a real quantity and T is a real quantity, etc. But let's assume that they are complex. Then it turns out that in this complex hyperplane, which is spanned by, you know, S and T and U, the postulate says that the only, so the function can have some singularities like poles and transfers, etc. But the postulate says that the only singularities this arithmetic has should be those which are consistent with unitarity and causality. And causality and locality I use interchangeably because in Minkowski space you'll get really the same thing. So this essentially, I mean, this postulate with technical and hard to explain, but essentially it was the essence of this postulate. So, okay, so then, you know, if you have this postulate, then we can ask, okay, can we rephrase our question? So we can ask, you know, what are all the functions of, say, for example, S and T, which we would call the S matrix of a quantum theory? But in order to answer this question, and you know, the fact that there is a postulate we have to satisfy, we have to find out all the singularities of the S matrix. And it turns out that this is a really hard problem. I mean, it is of course not solved yet at all. And even for perturbation theory, you know, it is very hard to find the classification principle of singularity in the sense that what are the, if I give you some function of S and T, any function of S and T, and I give you some singularities this function has in the complex S plane, how do I know whether these are singularities of a physical S matrix or not? And this is a very complicated problem. So, in fact, there's a nice quote by Isaacson and Huber in their book that study of complex singularities in amplitudes is indeed very complex because it's very hard to classify them. So in fact, you know, this so this is the main question we want to ask, which is how do we classify functions in minus some space which are say Lorentz invariant, unitary, and represent analytic S-matrix. And even for 2-2 scattering, it's not clear how to really satisfactorily answer this question. And you know, it will obviously be more complicated if we have n particles. So just to give an example of why these singularities are very difficult to classify, let's consider one example that we know very well, which is, you know, if you take say one loop scattering amplitude in 5-4 chain, 2-2 scattering in 5-4 chain, massive 5-4 chain, which we study in our QFT course. And now we can ask, okay, if I look at this object as a function of S and T, where are all the singularities of this function if I fix T and I vary S over complex T? So, you know, that I'm really simplifying the problem. I'm not even looking for all singularities in the S T space, just looking at the singularities in the complex S plane at a fixed T. Now, if you think from unitarity perspective, because the maximal analyticity postulate kind of tells you that, you know, you want all the singularities should be compatible with unitarity and locality, then it turns out that you would expect some fold to be there between S equal to 0 and S equal to 4 and M square, you know, in the sense that if you have, that is at most, okay, let me rephrase. So we know that, you know, that if you look at a one loop to scattering, then, you know, even if you have not done this before, it's a simple thing by looking at this expression, you can figure out that there's a branch cut in this function, which starts at 4 and because this function goes as, you know, roughly speaking, log of S minus 4 and square, blah, blah, blah. And okay, if there was some, if this was not a simple 5-4 theory, but there was some bound state coming, then you would expect some pole to be there between 0 and 4. And that's how unitarity would tell you. It cannot give you anything more, but it turns out that if you just look at this function, we evaluate it using Feynman diagram, then it has singularity, a very complex singularity at S equal to 0, because if you look at this function, it has one term which is like So the full function is like square root s minus square n square by s, which is I've written here, times a log s minus square n square. So at s equal to 0, there is a branch cut singularity here. And so, you know, this singularity has no origin in unitarity. So, you know, okay, but it's there in this example. So how do we know, how do we classify this singularity? These are called pseudo threshold, which don't come from unitarity. So that's the point, like, you know, full structure is very, very complicated. Of singularities to classify, even for simple five-fold theory is complicated. So we don't have a satisfactory answer to the question that, you know, even this question. So Santana was asking about non-perturbative asymmetric. We do not even have a satisfactory structural answer to the question is what is the perturbative definition of an analytic asymmetric. In this sense, like I give you a function of my minus some invariance, how do I know that it's an asymmetric of a local perturbative? Okay, so so we have seen two things right now, that Feynman diagrams are not always the best way to compute, and we don't know whether Feynman diagrams give us a good analytic definition of the asymmetric. But you know, we should realize that, you know, Feynman diagrams are, you know, if asymmetric is the object, a degenerate object, so Feynman diagrams, you know, we can think of them as representing the asymmetric. So you know, we write it in terms of Feynman diagram at the expansion. But as we saw in the case of MHC amplitude, that, you know, it's maybe not the most suitable way to represent. So here I don't mean representation in the math way, I just mean representation in our like normal English way, that, you know, we are representing a perturbative amplitude using Feynman expansion, but it may not be the best way to write the statement. And we saw the classic example of this in the Park-Taylor formula. And you know, so one thing about Feynman diagrams is because they come from Lagrangian, they design very tightly structured. Like manifest locality in the Lagrangian, right? And so if you start the Lagrangian, which is local, then obviously every step of the computation in the analysis of the amplitude, you will always have locality. And because of this, you know, as you know, we have some gauge redundancy, because then we have to work with gauge potential, et cetera, which often complicated. And in fact, it has come out in last, decade or so, that, you know, we now understand that even three-level estimated in the Young-Mills theory have hidden symmetry. You know, this is something called Parascala kinematics duality. It's a symmetry that is not manifest in the Feynman diagrammatic representation. And so this is sort of a little bit of a critique of Feynman diagrammatic expansion. And finally, as we saw, that it doesn't really lead us to a good structural definition of even a perturbative set. But you know, it doesn't help us classify all the singularities. So we can ask, okay, so is there a better way to write this? You know, for example, in which the simplicity of the MHV gluon amplitude is manifest. So this is one counter example to Feynman diagram. So we can ask, okay, is there a representation in which this would have been simple? This one would really come out in like a few steps. And indeed there is, and this representation goes under the name of BCFW recursion relation. But the idea is it's a very pretty idea that, you know, if you want to compute a three-level amplitude, you can do it always from lower point amplitude. You never have to go to Lagrangian. Like that, you can just start from like a baby amplitude, like a 3-point amplitude, and do recursive analysis to compute endpoint amplitude. The key here is that you have to complexify your moment. That's something that we never do in Feynman. So if you allow your external momentum to be complex, of course, in the end, you have to project back to real momenta. But if you allow to begin with for your momentum to be complex, then you can always stay within the world of amplitude. You never go to Lagrangian or field. And you can compute endpoint amplitude from 3-point amplitude, for example. But what happens if you look at this scheme? I mean, we don't have time to go into details of this scheme, but if you look at this scheme, it turns out that at intermediate steps, you don't have locality, unlike Feynman diagram. So Feynman diagram, you know, every Feynman diagram is local in a precise. But if you look at like every term in this equation, you will see that intermediate steps will have come, don't look like they are coming from any local Lagrangian at all. But you know, when you add everything, remarkably all the non-local structure cancels, and you get an answer which is local if you started with a local. But this kind of tells us something, that perhaps, you know, we should not start with locality or causality as a fundamental postulate, because you know that is what forced us towards Lagrangian and Feynman diagram. And of course this you know raises a more deeper question, that how did this happen, that you know you somehow start with some scheme where you have non-locality at intermediate steps, but always in the end the answer is. Some sort of analysis of this question gave rise to the positive geometry program. And then finally, so this is one representation that you know you would have liked if you want to extend the MHV amplitude. Of course, this representation, VCFW representation, and many, many other remarkable uses. But so, okay, so for example, you can say, okay, let's forget MHV and let's say I want to explore this, understand, is there a way to write amplitude of Yang-Mills in which is symmetry, you know, the so-called color kinematics duality, whatever it is manifest. And it comes out, there is a representation, it's called VCJ. Again, it's not important for our talk, it's just some representation which is not Feynman diagram type representation, which is also not true. So there are many, you know, just to be one final example, there is another one which is the most, I would say, most striking day-to-night amplitude in quantum field theory, which is inspired by spotability string amplitude. So as you know, that in string theory, we write, you know, if you want to look at string scattering, we write this amplitude in what is called worldsheet, on worldsheet. And it turns out that even for local quantum field theory, you can write amplitude as a, some sort of a worldsheet formula. And this is the most crazy representation, in the sense that even though it's an amplitude for local quantum field theory, the S matrix comes out as an integration of some kind of a some differential form of some tensor or a very auxiliary space. I mean, it's some abstract math space which has nothing to do with space time or momentum. It is some crazy space, some kind of a worldsheet on which you write some tensor and you integrate and you get. You can get amplitudes for Yang-Mills theory, effects for Yang-Mills theory, or phi cube theory, or phi four theory. So the reason this is a most striking representation is because, you know, neither unitarity or locality are manifest, because, you know, you don't even have space time or momentum space to begin with. You do everything on some obscure space. But in the end, the answer, of course, is unitary local, because, you know, you are computing the amplitude of local. So in this case, these are representations where both two of the fundamental postulates, the unitarity and locality, they are, you know, they are consequences rather than postulates. And there are others. Let me skip this one. So, you know, what is the lesson we are learning? I mean, so in a nutshell, I mean, the basic lesson is that, you know, we don't know a universal definition of what a perturbative S matrix is in the sense of a function of, you know, Mendelssohn invariance, which is unitary, local, and analytic. But we have many, many disparate representations, like Feynman, PHY, BCJ, there's something else I didn't talk about, Celestian amplitude. And if you want to look at the most extreme example of going away from Feynman diagrammatics, we can even go away a little bit from Minkowski space and look at quantum field theory in ADS. And here we know, thanks to ADS duality, that an ADS S matrix can be written in terms of CFT correlation function, which is like a completely non-local representation of the ADS S matrix. So, you know, so this is an extreme example. ADS FT duality could be thought of an extreme example where you go far away from the Feynman diagrammatic of the quantum field theory in ADS. And it turns out that some properties which are manifest in one representation become corollaries in the other. So locality, which is manifest in, you know, Feynman diagrammatic, is just a consequence in CHY. But they are all disparate representations. So, of course, so the natural question I want to ask is that, you know, why are there so many ways to write one estimate? So is there a framework in which, you know, all these disparate evaluations can be unified? And if there is one, you know, what are the fundamental postulates on which it could be based? Because now we are seeing that, you know, locality and unitarity are certainly not fundamental. They emerge in some of these other. So, and this is the, in a nutshell, this is the ambitious goal of this program that I want to describe. This talk. I haven't even started really my talk yet. That it's a perspective on amplitude, or we want to understand, we want to develop a structural definition of S matrix which encompasses different representations. So, you know, that's the ultimate goal. Of course, we are far, far away from completing it, but that's the goal with which you should use this program, whatever I'm going to talk about now. So maybe I stop here and see if there are some questions. This was broadly an introduction. Why
are
we interested in what
you're doing? Hello. Alok.
Hello.
Okay. Hi.
Oh, Chandra, hi.
Hi. Alok, hi. Yeah, I wanted to ask a question about the singularities thing which you pointed out. You of course gave an expression for the singularities which arise due to unitarity. But yeah. is it true that the singularities which arise due to locality are only the ones when the external particles go on shell, or there's like suppose you're given a final amplitude, can you?
Yeah, that's a very good question. So locality, yeah. So, you know, so when it comes to singularity, locality and unitarity kind of clear rolled together. So, you know, in the sense that this S equal to 4 M squared singularity is really a singularity, which is because of the fact that the theory is local. What unitarity, what unitarity tells you is that when you are on singular point, your amplitude factorizes into lower point amplitude because of optical scale. So I use here unitarity, but what I really meant was that, you know, it's a combination of this. So, you know, locality will tell you that we have a, you know, locality is telling us that, you know, we can produce in a setting either one particle or, you know, in the intermediate state, two particles, etc. So we can have a pole at M square, branch cut at 4 M square, etc. So, you know, and the way amplitude behaves at that single point is what unitarity is. So although I say unitarity here, but, you know, what maybe I should have really said is unitarity plus locality. I don't know if that was your question. These singularities I talk about, really you should view them as coming from locality. So, but there are other singularities like this one that square root s, which cannot come from locality. You know, it is not, it has no natural explanation from locality. It's that's why it's called a pseudo threshold, because, you know, it doesn't indicate that, you know, all the singularities which come from locality basically tell you have enough energy or something to produce an intermediate particle. You know, so s equal to 0 is something that is not. If you have two scattering, then you know that, you know, the you can produce. The minimum energy you have is 4 m squared, so you know that that is where the threshold is. So s equal to 0 is something that you don't expect from locality. I don't know if that was your question.
Yeah, I think you answered it. Thank you. Yeah.
No, that's a very good question, actually. Yeah, I was a bit cavalier about okay, so that's what we want to understand. So now what I want to do is to explain to you in the talk, you know, what this program is of positive geometry, and tell you how it kind of offers something, at least even at the level at which it is. It's relatively a recent program for non-supersymmetric quantum field theory. I mean, it is defined in 2017, but it has already offered some interesting insights, in my opinion, what the structure of SPC. Now, there's some, I mean, you know, because of the lack of time and the way the field has developed, we are going to focus on a particular class of theories or amplitudes. And let me explain this structure, because we will be using it throughout. So, you know, if you consider, for example, ordinary scalar field theory with cubic interest, then we know that, you know, this 4-point, if you compute 4-point scattering, then it has three Feynman diagrams, and so three, you know, there are three contributions. One is 1 minus 1 by s minus m square, t minus m square, u minus m square, and these are called channels. So we are, you know, either in the s channel, t channel, or u channel. But you can easily check that, you know, if you draw the Feynman diagram, like u channel diagram cross, in the sense that if you fix your ordering of particles on a plane, then only two of them are such that the Feynman diagram will not cross. It will be like a planar diagram. But the other one, if you draw one, like particles, arrange particles on a piece of paper in a clockwise direction, 1, 2, 3, 4, then S and T Feynman diagrams are planar. Like you can draw them without any lines crossing, but U diagram is not planar. Now it turns out that in gauge theory, like Yang-Mills theory, because with external particles have extra degree of freedom called a color, you can build everything from planar diagrams. So that's quite interesting. So just to give you an example, so let's say suppose you wanted to compute, say, three-level amplitude in Yang-Mills theory, four gluons, for example. Then it turns out that you can, the momenta of these particles are indicated at T1 to T4, and because they are gluons, they have polarization, which I have indicated as epsilon 1 to epsilon 4. And you can write this amplitude as, you know, sum of three terms, where these alphas, they are not important for us, but they depend on the gauge group of the theory. So, because, you know, Yang-Mills theory has color degrees of freedom, it could be like the SUN Yang-Mills theory. So this alpha will depend on SUN. And they are usually called color factors because they only depend on the gauge content and don't depend on momenta or polarization. Now, it turns out that each term which is multiplying with alpha I, so if you look at like the term multiplying alpha 1, which is some ns by s plus nt by t, where ns is a function of p1 and epsilon, p, the momenta and the polarization, but not the function of the color. So but if you look at it as a function multiplying alpha 1, you can see that it is always sum of two of the three possible Feynman diagrams. That is, you can always draw it as a planar diagram on a piece of paper for some arrangement of that. So this each term, for example, the term multiplying alpha 1, is what is called a color ordered amplitude. So that is like, you know, you fix the ordering of particles in a plane, and then you look at only those diagrams which are compatible with that order. And as you see from this equation, the full amplitude can be obtained by summing over color order. So they are like basic building blocks of of your full amplitude. And this is true for any theory which has colored diffusion. So this is the example in the final diagram case. So if you fix the order in the 1, 2, 3, 4 clockwise, then you can see that, you know, the first guy is what is usually called the C channel graph. The second guy is what is called the S channel. And the third is just the contact input. But we can never get a U diagram because it will not be planar. And so this is, you know, this is what we call a color ordered amplitude, where ordering should be 1 to 4. So if there's any question here, please ask, because, you know, this is the class of amplitude we will be working. But I want to emphasize that these are like bases. You know, so if you know these bases, we can multiply them with alpha, then get the full amplitude. It's not like you miss anything, but that's what we'll be working. So if you have any doubt, please. Yes.
So what is this NTNU? Can you please explain it a little bit more?
Yeah. So this NTNU, they are functions of P and epsilon. So for example, they could be, you know, P1 dot epsilon 2, P2 dot epsilon 3, etc. Because, you know, Yang-Mills vertex has derivatives. So you get some, you know, you don't only get like 1 by S, like in scalar field theory, because of the derivatives in the interaction, you get some functions of momenta in the numerator. So I just package it as NS because the detail form we don't need.
Okay.
But it is some regular function, you know, of P and epsilon. Yeah. Okay. So now, so that's what we. So these are the class of amplitudes we'll be working with. And now let's start with the basic idea. So what I'm going to do is lay out the very basic idea for you, and then try to do some examples to explain how it is actually implemented, and you will see how actually simple the program is. So of course, because we want to start with some, you know, we want to discover, like, you know, is there a, you know, definition of S matrix which, you know, unifies all this disparate representation. So we don't have to, we can't start with anything. If we start with anything, we are always going to be prejudiced. Like, we start with Lagrangian, then, you know, we are going to be prejudiced, and of course, we are going to probably go back to Feynman diagrams in one way or the other. So what we want to do is start with a very bare bones structure. So, you know, like, most empty possible structure we can start. Now, what is the minimum that we can start with? So of course, the, you know, if you are studying any quantum field theory in flat space time, we know that the amplitude is going to be function of, you know, minus time invariant, so basically scalar products of external moments. So that's the space that we can at least start. That's a bare bones space. That space only assumes that we have Poincaré invariant. So, you know, we are only utilizing one of the postulates and nothing more. And so, you know, any S matrix of a quantum field theory in flat space time will be a function on the space of Lorentz minus time invariant. This space is usually called kinematic space. It's kinematic because it has no information about any dynamics. It's a very kind of boring state. The subscript n means it just denotes the number of external particles that we have. So of course, the dimension of this space will change with the number of external particles. We have more scalar product of external momenta if you have more particles. So this is the second point I already explained, that, you know, we have already imposed Poincaré symmetry, but that's okay, because, you know, at least let's try to classify all possibility of keys in flat space. Now that the question we want to ask is that, you know, can we start classifying some functions which naturally come out of this space, like, you know, more so than others? And this question, you know, it looks like a ridiculous question, like, well, you know, we don't have anything to play with. But in a really exciting paper, Nima Rakhani Hamad, Bai, Fang, and Jun, they showed that, you know, they showed that there's enough structure on this empty space which naturally give you three-level amplitude for massless five-cube theory in any space time. So they found some structures on this space, and the structure was such that they gave some numbers or some functions of momenta, and those were nothing but amplitudes of the five-cube space. Now, what these structures are, which we are going to spend most of our time explaining, these are some geometric objects which are just living in this kinematic space, and they are really convex objects, like, you know, tetrahedra, triangles, etc. What was funny is that these objects are known. I mean, Nima and collaborators found them in the kinematic space, but they were known to mathematicians from 60, and they were, you know, a mouthful name. They are called associahedron. We will see also what this object. But this was the basic starting point for why this program, you know, actually, I mean, it kind of kick-started that, you know, in a very empty space, they found some geometric structure which gave them amplitude for some field. So they found more. So they basically found, you know, just sitting inside this kinematic space, these tetrahedra, this, you know, convex object, which we'll see in detail, of increasing dimension. So, you know, each, like one octahedra gives you amplitude for n particles, higher dimension one gives you for n plus one particles, etc. And in fact, the reason they give you amplitude, because you can think that, okay, if I just give you some object like a triangle drawing in a space, how can it give me some function, right? But it turns out that these polytopes actually do not come empty-handed. And each of them defines and is something mathematics has been for a long time. That, you know, if you find in any space this octahedra sitting, then in that space there is a unique, if you don't know what differential form is, it doesn't matter, you can just think of it as a function, that, maybe a little fancy name, that there's a unique function that you can define in this space, kinematic space, which comes along with this object. So and it is really this function which gives us the answer. We will see, it will become very clear when we see the actual example. And so this was the basic idea that, you know, you start with a very boring empty space and discover rich structure inside. So just to give you the idea in a very nutshell, that, you know, you start with say K4, so the four particles in a kinematic space. So remember, we are looking at color order categories. So we have only two variables. Suppose we think about ordering 1, 2, 3, 4, then as we discussed, you only have the S and the T channel, you don't get the U channel. So let's consider the let's consider the positive quadrant of this kinematic space they have drawn here. So to begin with, a very boring space, nothing is there. But it turns out that Niemann and collaborators found that there is this nice one-dimensional geometry sitting at 45 degree angle, which I have drawn there, such that it comes along with a unique function that you define in the kinematic space, which I have drawn written there. And that, as you can see, that's clearly the, you know, the color, like the planar amplitude, which is S and T condition. So just to sketch what where we are heading. But this was the basic idea. So, you know, from almost nothing, you will see that you from some basic combinatorial structure kind of. I mean, what I want to really emphasize and take you from this topic, that these objects are sitting in kinematic space. We have to really find them. We are not, you know, we are really not placing them.
So
this is the yes.
This figure, what is C? C is basically the center of mass or something like that.
Oh, sorry. I will describe what it is. I'm just drawn the equation for the line. So right now, P is just P intercept. I mean, no. There's no meaning here to it right now. I just, like, it is just the equation which describes that line that I've drawn there. Okay. You know, which intersects the, yeah. So it, as long as P is positive, you can obviously, you can see that it will intersect the positive S and the positive S. That's all. Thank you. But yeah, we will look at pretty much more detail. So this is just a small disclaimer which I will skip. I already discussed this. And the second disclaimer is something I wanted to discuss, that, you know, we want to work with color order amplitudes. Now you can see that, okay, well, gluons have color, they have gain degrees of color. So what about if I'm going to compute the pi cube amplitude, what do I mean by I'm looking at color order amplitude? And it turns out that you can think of, say, pions, for example. So you can think that your scalar fields also have color degrees, which is, of course, not uncommon. So you can think of Lagrangians, where your scalar field is not like an empty scalar field, but it takes values in some group, you know, FUN. So it is this class of theories. The theories go under some names, bio-joint scalar theory. That's not very important, but basically scalar field theory, where scalars also have some color degrees. And the reason we do this is simply because, you know, these ideas are most developed for this color ordered or planar amplitude. Planar in the sense that once I fix ordering, all the diagrams can be drawn on a plane. Planar does not mean large n or anything for alias safety experts here, just means, you know, that what we discussed earlier. Although for simplicity, we restrict ourselves for most of the talk with massless particles, you know, this results actually kind of trivially generalized if you have, say, this scalar field at any mass. And as we discussed in the end, if I have any time, that, you know, there is a very promising finds that we are able to extend them to like a generic scalar field interaction with, you know, different fields, different masses. So let's really start now. So we want to build from our kinematic space some start like filling it, like we want to find some geometric objects in the kinematic space. So first thing you have to do is like this, you know, coordinateize this space. I mean, this is the space of Mendelssohn invariant. And you can ask, okay, what is the convenient choice of variables that you can use? And there is a nice choice of variables that you can use, which I have denoted here. If they are denoted as x, y, j, which are very easy to define. So you know, because we have an ordering fixed, this is something you should always remember, that, you know, we have an ordering of particles fixed from 1 to n. So I can unambiguously say that label I is less than label j, for example, 1 less than n, for example, in the sense that 1 comes before n if I go clockwise. Then I can define, given this ordering, I can define the variable xij, which is defined here. You basically sum from pi to pj minus 1 and square it. And that scalar is a scalar because it's a scalar product. So this xij, they form a good basis for this phenomenon. So you look at this xij range over ijs properly, and you get a very good, like, convenient basis to write your scattering amplitude. What is interesting about the xij is that they have nice geometric picture, right? Because once I fix an ordering, which is what I've denoted below, once I fix an ordering, you can see that x1, 3 can be drawn as a chord in the polygon. So this polygon is nothing to do with any physics or nothing to do with moment or anything. It is just an abstract polygon, only came from the fact that we have a fixed ordering. But once I have it, this x1, 3, x3n as a bronze, they can be thought of as chords inside this polygon. So starting with that kinematic space, okay, we have this. The minimum we have is this fuseless looking geometric structure which has chords inside the polygon. Now, so what can we do with this geometric object? So first thing we can do is, okay, let's start with any set of these xij which dissect the polygons into cells. There's nothing more.
Hello, Alok. Other people can hear me? Hello, Alok.
Hi.
Yeah, suddenly my connection broke. Thank you for stopping.
No problem.
Yeah, continue.
Should I continue now, Panthan?
Yes.
Okay. Yeah. So it turns out that, you know, just from this, the fact that these xijs can be drawn as chords inside a polygon, and they can be used to dissect polygon into triangles, quadrilaterals, etc. It turns out that we can use this dissection. So I call this dissection. So these chords, because they dissect the polygon, like the 1, 3, I call it a dissection. So we can use set of such dissections, as you will see in the next slide, to construct some very abstract polytope. So polytope is, it's not something fancy. Polytope is just a higher dimensional generalization of a polygon. So like a tetrahedron is a polytope. But you can use this dissection, as you will see, to construct some abstract polytope. So just as an example, let's start with like say n equal to 5. So we are looking at 5 particles, and we have a ordering fixed. So we have a pentagon to begin with, and then we want to triangulate. So then we can triangulate it using, in 5 possibilities. Just to give an example here, so as you can see that you can, if you focus on the first vertex, it's one of the triangulations of a pentagon. So I have triangulated it using 2 chords, 1, 3 and 1, 4. Similarly, the second vertex, which is on the right, for example, I have triangulated it using 1, 3, 3, 5 and so on. And you can quickly check that there are 5 of these possible triangulations of a pentagon. And what it turns out that you can glue them together exactly as I've drawn here. You can glue these 5 triangulations together such that each of the triangulation is sitting on a vertex. And what you get as a result is a new pentagon. So this pentagon has nothing to do with the original pentagon of 5 particles, but it is a pentagon which is which is obtained by just from the combinatorics of this triangulation. So as you can see that the way we have glued these triangulations is, when I say glue, what we mean is that if you look at any 2 of the vertices, each of them have 1 dissection in common. So if you look at the top vertex and the one on the, I guess, on the right, it has 1, 3 dissection in common. Similarly, the top one and the one on the left, it has the 1, 4 dissection in common, and like that. So we can consistently glue it together like this and obtain a new polytope, which is a pentagon itself in this case. And this is called associativity. And since it has 2 dimensions, it is called a 2-dimensional associativity. So in fact, it turns out that this construction of gluing, you may think, okay, this is something very, one can only do for 5 points. And what if we start with, triangulation of n gon, then maybe I may not be able to do. But this is the this was the result of a mathematician called Stashev Nikitin, actually, that you can glue these triangulations together for any gon. So you start with the n plus 3 gon and glue it together, and you get a polytope which is of dimension n. So you notice that the dimension of the polytope is always 3 lower than the dimension of the n gon, and that is obvious because of the fact that the number of chords you need to triangulate an n plus 3 gon is n. Like in this case, you know, to triangulate a 5 gon, we need 2 chords. So and these are called associatives, which I'm denoting here as ASN. These are typos. I'm just going to call the associator an ACN from now on. So just think of this AS as AC. I use the wrong notation. Now this associator has many fascinating properties. So I just list some of them, which will become important for a symmetry amplitude. So again, I just want to say right now, you may think this is nothing really to do with physics, which it doesn't at this point, but it will become clear why we are looking at. Right now, you see one thing that if someone only gave you this planar kinematic space Kn, what more you could do, and you know, you have nothing better to do in your life, and this is all you would be able to. So one interesting property of the associator is that it is boundary of all co-dimension or boundary of all possible lower dimensions. And these class of shapes are called positive joints. So just to give an example, if you take a disk, it is not a positive geometry because a disk has a boundary of, this is a two-dimensional object. It has a boundary of one dimension, which is a circle, but it has no boundary of zero dimension because it doesn't have any vertex or anything like that. But if you take a square, then it is a positive geometry because it has a boundary of dimension one, which are the edges, and it also has boundaries of dimension zero, which are the vertices. So it turns out that associatedra are like squares in terms. They have boundaries of all possible lower dimensions. If you look at the n dimensional associatedra, then it will have a boundary of dimension n minus 1, n minus 2, all the way to 0, all the way to 0. And this property, which is something again that mathematicians had realized some time back, that if you give me any positive geometry, not just associates, any positive geometry which has all boundaries of all possible lower dimensions, then if you put them in some Euclidean space, you take a tetrahedron and you put it in Rn, then it turns out that there will always induce a unique function or a form which has a property that if you think of this such that this function has simple poles only on the boundaries of this positive geometry and nowhere else. So in other words, if I take a square and I embed it somewhere, it has this property that if I take a square and embed it in R2, like a 2D space, then there is a unique form that you can define on R2 such that it has simple poles on all the boundaries of square and nowhere else. And that form you cannot change. That is a result one can prove. And another property which as you will see also is important for physics. I'm only listing properties which are important for physics. Of course, all these properties require some work to prove that if you take any boundary of association, that it is always a product of lower dimensional association, right? Nothing else. And this is quite an interesting property. So for example, if you take a one-dimensional associator, it's just a line with two vertices, and that's all it is. And a two-dimensional associator, we call here, is itself a pentagon. Now, if you look at this pentagon, look at its boundary. So each of its boundary is either a line or a vertex, or if you look at a boundary of dimension one, then it's an edge. If you look at boundary of dimension zero, then it's a vertex. Both of which are associated because zero dimensional vertex is a zero dimensional associated and one dimensional edge is one dimensional. So each boundary of this pentagon is itself a dual lower dimensional. Now this property here is a bit trivial, but actually this property extends to all associated in the sense that suppose you look at a three dimensional associated, whatever the object is, it is such that its boundary can never be a hexagon. So its boundary can either be, if you look at one of its two dimensional boundary, it can either be a pentagon, which is a two-dimensional associator, or it can be a square, which is a product of two one-dimensional associators. But it cannot be anything else. Like it cannot be a hexagon. So it has a very tight structure. In general, you can draw a convex three-dimensional polytope, which can have boundaries which are hexagons of second type. But associator is not of that type. And again, this is a property that you see why it's important for people. Now, the way we got this associator is by gluing. So we went from top vertex, which has two dissections, 1, 3, 1, 4, and we flipped one. So if you look at the guy on the vertex on the right, we flipped this 1, 4 to 3, 5. Now you see that if you took 1, 3, 6, there is no other flip that is possible. You could have only fixed 1, 4 to 3, 5. This flipping is what is called mutation in math literature. So you mutated your 1, 4 to 3, 5, and you can see that mutation is unique. There's no other mutation, right? You know, only this one. So that's what I write here, that, you know, the flip, if you flip one diagonal, say 1, 3, 1, 4 to 2, 4, 1, 4, so you flip 1, 4, 6 and flip 1, 3, then it's called mutation, and you know, this is unique. There's only one mutation at every time. However, this property will not work if you have dissected your polygons in quadrilaterals as opposed to triangles. Then your mutation will not be unique. So let me just give you an example. That, you know, so the spiral triangulation, just because, you know, it is, as we discussed earlier, that this exercise can dissect the polygon in all possible. So here is a triangulation which gives us a nice polygon combinatorially for association. But you can ask, what if I start quadrangulating my polygon? What do I do? So if you start with a fixed gone, suppose you're looking at n equal to 6 particles, and if you're ordering, and suppose you want to break it into 2 quadrilaterals. So, you know, the top guy is like breaking the hexagon into 2 quadrilaterals obtained by, you know, 1 line, 1 4. But, you know, now you can see that in 1 4 can be quote unquote mutated in 2 possible ways. It can be mutated towards 3 6, and it can be mutated towards 2 5. So there is something complicated about it. It's not a unique mutation. But, you know, if you want to glue these guys together and obtain a polytope, then mathematicians have shown that, you know, I'm simplifying a lot. It is a little bit more complicated here, but they have shown that basically, if you start with 1 4 and you pick a mutation which is counterclockwise, so the one which is 1 4 going to 3 6, then you can indeed glue all these quadrangulations also together by mutating, and you obtain a nice class of closed polytopes, which have like a funny name. They're called accordiahedra. And so accordiahedra are like, you know, I should say something, I should be a bit more precise here. When mathematicians refer to accordiahedra, they mean like entire family of polytopes which are obtained by dissecting an n-gon into any basic cell, triangle, quadrilateral, anything else. And so you get a full family of accordiahedra. The first guy is associated, where you have broken your pentagon into smallest possible set, which is a triangle. And associated, as you will see in a moment, is a rather unique member. I mean, one of the biggest reasons it's a unique member is because this mutation is unique when we have triangulation. And it's not unique if you have anything else. So if there are any questions right now about this, because I covered something, maybe with the news, so please ask. But I just want you to differentiate between the uniqueness of mutation in the triangulation case and the sameness of the quadrilateral.
Just one thing. Here you're dealing with the here you're only dividing these two-dimensional graphs, right, into various.
This is only for simplicity, that, you know, so this is particular. This is so the polygon is always two-dimensional. Remember, you abstract polygon. So for any number of particles, n particles, the polygon that we are starting with, this, you know, boring polygon, that's always two-dimensional. We are building higher-dimensional objects from the you know, from the triangulation, quadrilaterals, etc. So, you know, so let me just go back. No, that's a good point. So, you know, if you look at the last line here, that, you know, if you start with the n plus 3 gone and you divide it into triangles, we get a association of dimension n. So that is, you know, 3 dimensions lower. So if you had started with, I didn't draw it because it's a bit of a mess to draw, but if you had started with this hexagon, and you look at the polytope you get by triangulating. So then the polytope you get is a three-dimensional association, not
two-dimensional. Right.
Okay.
Right. Okay. Yeah. Cool. Okay, I understand. Okay, one more point I think that you made is that we are only interested in the singularities which occur at the boundaries of
what I'm saying is that this is something we will see again, but it's not like they're interested. It's like what we get. So the point is that, given this combinatorial object, they naturally give you a unique, differential form, which has singularities only corresponding to the boundaries of this polytope. You will see this in more detail, but it's not like we are choosing this form, it is given to us once we have this object.
I see. I see. And just to clarify the
No,
I just wanted to clarify the meaning of the boundary. Boundary means both the vertex and the edge, right?
Like everything, all customer boundaries. Okay. Like vertex, edge. If you have three dimensional tetrahedra, then you can have a two dimensional boundary as we discussed, right? Pentagon or a square. Okay. Yeah, all boundaries.
Okay, cool. Thanks.
Samson, you can also tell me how much time I have because I'm way behind, but I can stop anywhere.
No, you just go ahead.
Okay, you know, but if people get tired, please.
Nobody is feeling tired. It's very interesting. Please go ahead.
Okay. So now the point is that if you start with this, so this is what mathematicians told us. You start the hexagon, and if you're interested in breaking the quadrilateral, then you know you choose the mutation which goes counterclockwise. If you start with 1-4, then you go to 3-6. You know, so that now you have this. So that you can see that. So you can forget the 2-5 guy. And so what this is given you is a one-dimensional combinatorial polygon. So it's an object which has two vertices, one vertex labeled by the quadrangulation 1-4, that's 1-4 dividing the hexagon, and the other vertex dividing the hexagon into by 3-6, by the chord 3-6. So this is called a one-dimensional acordiahedron labeled by the chord 1-4. Now here, what is important here is that the initial choice of the dissection is important. So because we started with 1-4, we got 3-6. But if you started with 3-6, clearly you can see that counterclockwise of 3-6 is 2-5, and you would have got a different accordion. So this is unlike the case of asociahedra, because you know there, as we saw, because mutation is unique, you can start from any one of the vertices, and you will always get all the 5 triangles because these are all the triangulations they are. So the asociahedra that we get is AC2 doesn't depend on which triangulation we start with. It's independent. That's why we don't have any label here. But in this case, there is a label which kind of tells you your initial dissection. So that's the key difference between these acordiahedra obtained from quadrangulation and the ones. And this dependence of the initial dissection persists for any other dissection other than triangulation. And which is, this is what makes the associator like a unique member. Yes, so this is another example of an accordiahedron, now of a two-dimensional accordiahedron, where if you start with the 8-gon instead of a 6-gon, and you break it into, say, you want to break it into a quadrilateral. So you can start with, say, the initial configuration, which is 1-4-1-6, and you follow this counterclockwise rule nicely, and you can easily check that you get a pentagon, which is this thing that, which has each vertex, which is labeled by one particular quadrangulation that I've indicated. So these are two examples of accordiahedra obtained from quadrangulation. So these are really now, so one has nothing to do with any physics, they're just combinatorial objects. They just obtained because we have ordering of them. Like that's it, like nothing else. And the fact that our XYJs have a nice natural geometric meaning as chords. So like just, let me just summarize this of thing, but please feel free to stop me anytime. So for any dissection, I just give some examples. If you read any of the nice literature, you can see that the very easy way to understand this is that for any dissection of a N1, you get one combinatorial polytope, one polytope. So if your Q is a triangulation, then this polytope is unique because it doesn't depend on what triangulation you start. You can start with any triangulation of that N1, you get the same association. As we saw, this is called association. But if Q is anything other than triangulation, then the memory of which Q you start with remains. In this case, you start with 1-4-1-6, you get a pentagon. And I didn't draw it, but you can check that if you start with 1-4-5-8, which is the second vertex here, then you get a square polytope. You don't even get a pentagon if you follow this counterclockwise. So the polytope retains the memory of what dissection you start with. But of course, all of them will have the same dimension. The dimension of this polytope, as a rule of thumb, you should remember, is just the cardinality of the set Q. So if your Q has two elements, dimension is 2. Q has 10 elements, dimension is 10. And this is related to this nice fact that if you start with a triangulation or a quadrangulation or I call pedulation a poor word, but what I mean is like a breaking into three triangles, quadrilaterals, etc., then the polytope you get, the dimension of this polytope is always the same as the number of propagators you would have in an endpoint amplitude in a pipe for the 5-3 interaction. So if you, for example, just to give an example, if you look at endpoint amplitude with only cubic interaction, 5-cubic interaction, then the number of propagators you can count is n-3, which is precisely the dimensionality associated. So this is just a, at this point, it's just a numerical coincidence, but okay, fine, nice, have it. Now we can ask, okay, why are these polytopes interesting? They don't really have anything absolutely to do with physics. But the reason that is interesting is because actually they are just sitting there in the, even in fact, not even in the full kinematic space. Like, you know, they are just sitting there in the positive quadrant of the kinematic space. So remember that this kinematic space is parameterized or coordinatized by these variables xij's that we defined earlier. So if you just look at the quadrant where all the xij's are, you know, greater than or equal to zero, then you can just find these polytopes. You know, they are just sitting there. And so all we have to do, and actually that is something that, you know, for most part mathematicians have already done, at least for some of these polytopes, is to find them. So if we find them, then we have already started getting interesting geometric structures in the kinematic space almost from nothing, just from basic commutators. But when we say we want to locate them, means what? Like, we have to, obviously this kinematic space is space with, you know, a lot of Mannichan variables. And if I want to find, say, a pentagon inside, I have to locate it, means what? I need some equations to locate the, you know, a pentagon inside a kinematic space. Now, kinematic space is a Euclidean space. I mean, it has no metric and it's a basic boring vector space. And of course, immediate question you can ask is that if I gave you a pentagon, like, you know, like a two-dimensional associated, it can be drawn in this space in infinitely many ways, right? I can draw a pentagon in a plane in many ways, with different slopes, etc. And however, this was the kind of an interesting thing that, you know, independently mathematicians had found that there were some ways of drawing them which were, you know, which were, unfortunately, I can't go more into the detail, which were for mathematicians preferred compared to other ways of drawing. So if I take a, you know, if I take a pentagon, I can draw it inside a space in, you know, in, at different angles from different mathematical considerations, which are tied to different field called cluster algebra. One way of drawing it is preferred compared to the other. And it turns out, and this is something which I find the most remarkable part of this thing, that it is these realizations which turn out to be relevant for physics. So, you know, this was something which is so crazy that, you know, I still can't get one's head around it, that, you know, something in a math field which was very different kind of gave us something which is the one way to draw them which became relevant for and okay, this is something that we see in the next slide now. What are the ways to draw them that mathematicians gave us and why they are? Just a small technical remark that this kinematic space, because we are looking at master scalar field theory, so there's no scale or anything in the theory. So just for, you know, it's not an important point for students, but this kinematic space should really be thought of as a projective space. So there's no scale. You don't think that there is any 1 meter, 2 meter. There's no scale to this coordinate. Think of it as just a space which is this, which can be small or large, we can distinguish. Now, in some sense, all the hard work in finding this realization, at least for associated, not for other polytopes, was done by Nima and their collaborator, and it was followed by two groups of mathematicians. So for the case of associated, it was done by Hugh Thomas and collaborators, and for a generic octahedra, it was done by these four mathematicians, names are there. And as I said, that when we say we want to find them or realize them, we need some equations. So let me tell you what these equations are. They are really easy, so easy that you can play with them, like, without any pain. They're really easy to understand what the equations are which make us draw them. So just to write the equation, I have to introduce another notation, new notation. So, you know, let's call Sij Ti plus Pj square. So this is what we would usually call Mandelstam invariant in a POP textbook. And you can just from algebra check that this Sij is this linear combination of Xij, which I have written here. Now, this is the theorem that four mathematicians gave. For triangulation, it was given by Nima and others, but for any quadrangulation, it was given by the case that, you know, so let me first tell you for triangulation, then we will generalize it. So let's say, suppose we have some of my notations are wrong. So let's say we have a triangulation Q, which is from which we obtain associated random, I should have called it AC, I'm sorry, ACN of dimension N. And let us say that QC, I will draw this, they will draw in the next slide. So I'm first stating the theorem, then I'm going to explain it with an example. So let's say you take an N-gon and you triangulate it. And let's say QC is a triangulation which is just obtained by rotating Q counterclockwise. Then it turns out that you just write the following linear equation. So you take Sij, which is written, here, and put all the Sij's equal to negative constant if Ij's are not in this counterclockwise rotated Q, QC. So if this is a mouthful, I will explain the next slide. But let me just repeat. So you look at Q, you get QC. QC is built out of a lot of chords. Look at all the ideas which are not in this QC, and then write the equation for all such ideas. That's it. So this precisely gives you equations, which when you draw, like you solve this equation, you get a closed polytope in your kinematic space, which is a realization of this accordion. I mean, intuitively, okay, one maybe it's not a very good way, but maybe intuitively, one way to understand this for triangulation is that, you know, they basically freeze all the Manisha variables which are never occur as poles of the propagator. I mean, in hindsight, this is not something you use as an input, but in hindsight, you can see that, you know, this will freeze all the, this will become more clear in the next. So let me just explain without going more general. So let's say that we start with a triangulation, which is a 1-3. Now, what is the counterclockwise triangulation to 1-3? It is 2-4. So we write this equation, Sij equal to minus Kij, for all ij's which are not in the counterclockwise triangulation. But there is one, of course, the counterclockwise is 2-4. So the only equation we can write in this case is the equation for 1-3, which is x1-3 equal to minus t1-3. And this equation can be, because x can be written in terms of x, we can write this equation as the equation written on the right hand. So we get an equation which is x1-3 plus x2-4 equal to a constant. Now, if you take t to be positive, you can draw this line in the positive part of the space, and no principle in math is telling you what this t is. So this is completely arbitrary positive constant, because we are building everything from scratch. We don't want to put any physics input to bound this t right now, and so we don't have any bound one. Okay, fine. And so this is the line, but okay, let's take t to be positive just for simplicity. Then you can draw this as a line in the positive quadrant of x1-3, x2-4. So we've got a 45 degree line, which is a realization, which is one way to draw the one-dimensional association. Remember, one-dimensional association is just a line with two vertices. You can draw it at any angle, like there's no problem, right? But kind of mathematician is telling you that no, you have to draw it in this way only. From whatever consideration we have, which is really seemingly initially had nothing to do. Similarly, if you follow the same procedure and take the two-dimensional association to the pentagon, then it has a very specific realization in the kinematics. So I give you that realization that, you know, if you take the kinematic space and take this axis x1-3, particular form. So you see that all the edges are at 90 degrees or either parallel to the x-axis or 90 to x-axis, except one face, one edge, which is at a 45 degree angle. And that one corresponds to the x2-4 boundary, x2-4 equal. But, you know, this is the shape. So is there any question at this stage? So is anything not clear? So this, it's very easy to draw, locate, find them, because mathematicians told us the equation theorem is a theorem we use to find them.
Alok, will you be explaining later how these PIGs are related to XIJ, or like can you?
The PIGs are just constant right now. They're not at all related.
I mean the physical.
Okay, very good point. I understand. So like, let me explain here. Okay, good. Explain it here maybe. So let's look at this equation. So the equation is x1-3 plus x2-4 is c1-3. Right? Now, x1-3, if you remember the definition of xij is pi plus dot 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 pj minus 1. So x1-3 is just p1 plus p2 the whole, which is, you know, in the standard QFT terminology, it's just s, kind of some variable s. And similarly, x2-4 is just p2 plus p3 the whole square, which is just t. So this equation is telling us that s plus t is t. Right? Is that okay, Chandra?
Right, yeah. Sounds
but you good, know yeah. That for massless scalar field theory, we know that S plus T plus U is 0. That's the relation for U, S, U value. So this equation is telling you that U is minus U. So this equation kind of relates S T to the non-planar variables, which never occur in the planar or the color of the system. So this is telling you that if you freeze your U to be negative T, then it gives you a particular realization of the one.
I see. Okay, cool. Thank you. Yeah. And Alok, sorry, one more question was in this previous slide, is there any meaning of the angles, like 90 degree or 45, or that's not important?
That's an excellent point. Yeah, there is, a direct meaning. If the angle was not 90, we will not get the right physics back. So the fact that this angle is 90 is going to ensure that we that object we come, this form that we have has is consistent with unitarity and locality. It is really quite an amazing statement. That we, if we did not get 90 degree, whatever we obtain will not be unitary. Maybe it will be related to science and non-unitary dissipative amplitude, you know, at the end of the day. But, you know, as I was telling him also when he asked that, this naturally seems to pop up for us unitary amplitude, and it is precisely tied to this growth of 90.
I see. Okay. Yeah. And even this one angle, which is like at 45 or whatever.
Exactly. If I change it a little bit, I don't get unitary amplitude. I see. It will directly impact unitary.
Okay. Cool. Thank you.
Yeah, there is absolutely no freedom here, like, you know, at all. Okay. I mean, the sense that if you want the starting amplitude, like, this is rigid. Yeah, that's a really good question. Yeah. So, in fact, you know, like, one can do more that, you know, so of course, this accordion hybridizer we are now seeing, you know, we can realize them as polytopes in the kinematic space, but actually, one can do more. And this is something we showed with Anish Brunmai, Pinaki, Ranjan, and Sujoy. Anish is still a student. Sujoy was student just till, I think, well, technically, Sujoy, I think he's still a student, but he submitted. Brunmai is a beginning graduate student, and Pinaki and Ranjan are postdocs. So we showed that, you know, in fact, we can do more in the sense that all the other associated algebra can be realized inside the associated algebra. So in that sense, you know, associated is like a master polytope. You know, it's unique in the way that we discussed earlier, that, you know, it's very, you know, there is only one polytope, one associated in any dimension, and everything else can be fit inside of it. So it's a nice polytope in that sense. Okay, so that's the last point is what the main summarizing what we have so far. So is there any question right now at this stage?
I think
okay. Panel, really, please don't hesitate. Okay, tell me when to stop. Not a
problem. I'm not hesitating. You just, when I feel you will stop. You just
okay. Can't. Okay. So this is just the example of the result we had with Anish, Sujoy, Murumai, and Ranjan and Pinaki, that, you know, if you take this one dimensional acodiahedra that we had drawn earlier, which is this guy, this one, it can be realized inside the three-dimensional acodiahedra. There's a unique way that we can realize it inside this three-dimensional acodiahedra. And these are other implications that we discussed in our paper, which I won't go into right now, but that was one interesting result. So I kind of tell you that associatra is enough, like, you know, in some sense. I mean, if you realize associatra, other amplitudes you can obtain just from associatra. So far we have got some structure in the kinematic space from nothing, but we don't have enough to compute amplitude. And this is the final missing ingredient, that, you know, this embedded acodiahedra, they give us a unique form in the kinematic space, and these forms are essentially the amplitudes of some scalar field theory with color. So far, we are not talking with any theory, Lagrangian, like, anything, but, like, you see that you start getting amplitude from this realization. So, let me first again give a basic idea, then discuss some examples. So, you know, we started with this combinatorial acodiahedra, which we call ACQ, and, you know, what we already saw that we get one structure in kinematic space, which is a realization of acodiahedra as a geometric object. And now what I'm going to explain is that we are going to get we are given a canonical form, like a unique form of the same dimension as the about two dimensional form omega q. And once you have this form, so this form is in a full kinematic space. It has this interesting property that it has simple poles on the boundaries of this realized accordator, etc. But once you restrict it onto this convex realization of ACQ, that restriction just produces amplitude for some scalar. So that's the main result. So let's give an example and then explain the more general result. So let's again look at this four particle scattering, where we have this associahedron, which is one dimensional. So remember, it's a one dimensional associahedron. Here I've slightly wrongly denoted it as in the sense of because I wanted to write it as an acodiahedra, I denoted it as Q equal to 1, 3, but you should remember that the associator should never depend on what the initial Q is. Even if you have it 2, 4 as the initial dissection, it would still produce the same associator. But because you know, I'm giving uniform notation ACQ for any potato, I just use. So now it turns out that this, already before we realize it, this combinatorial guy give us a unique form in the code, you know, on this, in this, sorry, in this two-dimensional kinematic space A4, and this is the form. So it's a form that is just, you know, it's a form which was just given, I will explain slightly better how we got this form, but, you know, it is a form, as you can see, which has only two simple codes, one at x1 equal to 0, and one at x2 equal to 0, and these both are the boundaries of this associator. And there's a mysterious minus sign that I will explain on the next slide. But modulo the minus sign, it has this property that, you know, as I was telling you earlier, that it is simple code only on the boundaries and nowhere else, and on all the boundaries. Now, if you take this form, you know, some of the mathematicians gave us, and we restrict it on this line that was the realization of the associator, x1 equals x2 plus 2 constant, then you know you can immediately see that it gives you this term, which is the color ordered amplitude for 5-6-4-point amplitude. Again, I mean, the obviously this would be interesting if it's only for four particles, of course. So it turns out that this can be realized for any n. And so this is the prescription. Again, I'm just giving you the prescription that, you know, start with the n-dimensional octahedron ACQ, and start with any vertex. And so you know, it has many vertices. You start with whichever vertex you want, it doesn't matter. And you know, start putting signs on each vertices, such that any two adjacent vertices are opposite signs. So you start with any vertex, you put a sign plus. And you make sure that the adjacent, if it has many adjacent vertices, you try to see that you can consistently put all the opposite adjacent vertices with opposite signs. It turns out that these are such remarkable objects that you can actually do it. You can actually consistently put signs on vertices such that they are adjacent vertices of opposite signs. And once you have that assignment, then you can define this mod two-dimensional form on the kinematic space, which I've just written here. So you sum over all the vertices, and you know, if you started with a vertex V which has sign plus, then you know you have fixed signs for everything else. And then on each vertex, you have many xij's, you know, because at each vertex you have many faces which are incident on it. So you basically take a wedge over all the xij's which are labeling these faces, and it gives you some form. Okay. Now this form has a kind of a striking property, and this is what the sign, this is why the sign was chosen. And the property is that these forms are projective in the following sense, that you know, if I look at this form and if I scale both x13 and x24 with any function of in the kinematic scale, then this form doesn't change, because you know, you can just think of this form as d log x13 by x24. So if I scale x13 and x24, the form doesn't change. And this is what I should have, because my space had no scale in it, kn has no scale in it. So if I have a natural form I'm putting there, it cannot depend on any scale. And this property is what is called projectivity. So that, you know, that is how the forms, the signs arise. You know, if you had a plus sign here, we would not have a projective form. And of course, so you see that if you, and just as a small remark, that this projectivity is actually like a baby analog of, actually not really analog, it's more than that, but okay, at a basic level, it's kind of an analog of what is known as dual conformal invariance in, sorry, this should be n equal to 4, super young. And if you use a triangulation, then this form is unique, because triangulation is unique, means the associator is unique, if the associator is unique, the form is unique. And so we have a unique form, and we have a unique associator in the kinematic. So you see, we have two objects now. We have the form and the convex realization. And we do what we did here. We take the form and we fix it onto the associator inside the kinematic space, we get the amplitude. And that's exactly what happened. So if you look at this equation 6, I take my form and I restrict to whatever my realization of associator was, which was given by mathematician. I get some differential form like dx dot 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 dot. That's not important. Whatever multiplies it is precisely the amplitude for pi cube space. So it just came out, really, it really came out from the associator, geometry of associator. So that's one of the main results of our Arkan-Hamilton collaborator. So you see that the sequence of how we went is denoted below, that you start with the, you know, the triangulation Q, you got a combinatorial polytope, and that gives you two things. One is the form and one is the conceptual language. And the two together kind of give you the amplitude of a theory, which is in this case. So now actually I won't go too much into detail, but this result can be generalized to generic scalar interactions, and we investigated this a lot in this paper with the earlier collaborator Anish Pujay and Jayanti, that you know, that we can generalize this result to any 5W interaction, but you know, but the final is slightly more subtle in the sense that here you have a single form. So if you look at equation 6, there is one form, you know, the omega is restricted to our associated, which basically pops out the amplitude. Here things are a little bit more subtle because in any dimension we have more than one accordia hedra. So, you know, if I start with like a hexagon, remember that, you know, I could have started with 1-4 as a quadrangulation, I got one accordia hedra, but if I started with 3-5, I would have got another accordia hedra. So I have to, so, and each accordia hedra is going to give me one form, you know, in the kinematic space, because the form, the way we build form is precisely this equation 5. You give me a cube, I build a form for it. You give me a commutative polytope, I build a form. So for each commutative polytope, I have one form. So it turns out I have to add all of them, you know, because I have more than one polytope. But there is a way to do it, and there's a specific unique linear combination of these forms such that if you look at them, they give you amplitude for some scalar field theory for some 5W. So in the end, again, the basic building blocks are, so these alpha cubes are some numbers, and they are determined precisely by the combinatorics of accordia hedra. So in the, at the end of the day, given the combinatorics of accordia hedra, it gives us enough structure in the kinematic space to build amplitude for 5W. Okay, so let me just go a little fast now. So let's see why this, how much time I hope I'm super over time in this. Why did it work? You know, so you, I mean, of course, if you're thinking for the first time, you should be surprised that starting from very basic combinatorics, we got some structures like, you know, this guy here, 1 by s plus 1 by t, like the last line, 1 by x1 plus 1 by x2, which is a unitary, which is an amplitude for pi 16, which is a unitary and local amplitude. So, you know, you can always wonder, like, how did we get this unitarity and locality? And this is related to many questions you guys asked before. And they all, these properties emerge due to, you know, this striking properties of accordia hedra and this realization that magnificence gave us. That, you know, one of the properties that was important is that if we zoom in towards any of the boundary of the accordia hedra, we always get a accordia hedra or a product of accordia hedra of lower dimension. You know, this is something we discussed before, so let me just skip this. And this property that, you know, if the boundary of accordia hedra is a product of the lower dimension accordia hedra, is what actually gives us a unitary, I mean, amplitude which is unitary. You know, and the reason it is unitary is the following, that, you know, if unitarity is what? That if you go on shell, if you go on shell in any channel, then break into product of two lower point amplitude. That's the statement of unitarity. And that's what this is the combinatorial statement of, that if I go in any of the boundary, I break the polytope into two lower dimensional polytopes. And the fact that we got locality is because we have a simple pole only, we have no other pole. And the simple pole came because the mathematicians told us that there is a unique differential form that we have in kinematic space as soon as we have this combinatorial drive. And in fact, I just because of lack of time, I won't go into the detail, but you know, what is amazing is every time something happens, it looked like, okay, you know, this would work at higher loops, etc. But this same structure, really pretty much the way it is, generalizes to, you know, if you look at massless or a single massive scalar field and you want to go to one loop, in the sense that, you know, for one loop, you know, we have to, of course, if you want to do a one loop setting, you have to integrate. So what you start with is the integrand, and in terms of this integrand, it's pretty much like the tree level amplitude, in the sense that it is really emerges out of differential forms and some positive geometry, some polytope. So if you ask how universal is this idea, there are some promising signs that it may be more, you know, more general than what we have initially anticipated. But of course, then another question we can ask is, okay, I don't want to go to higher loops with one massless scalar field. What if I had, you know, more than one field, one is massive, one is massless, and I want to, you know, integrate out massive field? Can I do all these things in this world of polytope? So let me just quickly tell you what happens for the one loop case. First, I'm not going to give any details, just flex some pictures. That if you want to compute, say, the integrand for the one loop propagator in the pi cube theory, it turns out that comes from a positive geometry which is a square which I've just drawn here. The don't worry about the vertices. These are some triangulations of some polygons with holes. It's not important. But this particular polytope, which is it is like a octahedra, and it's called type D cluster polytope. Actually, you know, it is like a octahedra in the sense that octahedra in mathematics literature goes by a different name. It's called a type A cluster polytope. There are four types of cluster polytope: type A, type B, type C, type D. So what is striking is that type A gives you three-level amplitude for phi cube here, and type B gives you the one-loop integral for phi cube. And it turns out that, you know, if you are motivated enough and you want to find polytopes which also generate integrand for say phi 4 theory or phi to the p theory, then you can do little bit, you can go beyond what mathematicians have gone to, in the sense that these polytopes are actually not known before, but now we were interested in them, we went looking for them, we found them. So these polytopes are what we call pseudo octahedra, and I'll give you one example. This is a pentagon. It's a polytope which gives you the one loop integrand for phi 4 theory, 4 point amplitude in phi 4 theory. And I've just indicated different vertices with, you know, different. So each vertex, what pole it corresponds to, I have just integrated that with the Feynman diagram. This is just to show that, you know, the picture can be extended. But like, let me just now maybe just take 5 more minutes to tell you something which I actually find kind of quite exciting. It is, suppose, you know, you wanted to go beyond the world of like a single scalar field. So you know you have two scalar fields, massive, one massless and one massive, and you know you want to evaluate three level amplitude, color ordered, etc. Both the scalar fields are color, so we can talk about color ordered amplitude. But phi one is massless, phi two is massive, and let's say we want to evaluate the perturbation. So let's say we want to evaluate this amplitude up to order lambda. You start evaluating this amplitude, you get amplitude lambda 1 cube. The second term is lambda 1 square, lambda 2, so on and so. Now it turns out that, you know, you can ask, can you get this from this positive geometry and form? And you can, and in fact, the combinator polytope you need is really just the octahedra. So the fact that these are both cubic interactions, you don't need anything else. It turns out that if you look at octahedra, these are other realizations in kinematic space, which go beyond what the mathematicians gave us. So I will explain in a moment. So they don't go beyond the mathematician in the sense that they are not, the angles and all don't change, but you can put them in different places with regards to the origin of kinematics. So it turns out that, you know, there are these, now that you have a scale in the scale, because, you know, you have a massive field. You don't have your kinematic space is not like a projective space. So you can really think of it as a Euclidean space. And then you can talk about the origin and size of this polytope. And there are these five different realizations of this octahedra. So they have same angles and they have the same, you know, as before what we have drawn, but they're put in different places. And the red lines indicate that the size is in different directions. And it turns out that these five together give you the 5-point amplitude for this theory. So this is something we call octahedra block. Again, this realization is something mathematicians had not looked at because, you know, they are not interested in physics. But they just really come out of the. If you look for them, you know what you want. They really come out very nice. And it really gives you the amplitude for arbitrary coupling, you know, which is the quite a striking part. So, you know, lambda one, lambda two can be anything. So the fact that you can add the, you know, different contributions to get the correct amplitude, I think it's fairly monumental. So let me now just conclude. I'm really sorry I went way over time. That, you know, in a nutshell, we have interesting indications that that the positive geometries in kinematic space lead to sort of a novel restructuring of asymmetric programs, you know, where unitarity and locality are just consequences but not fundamental postulates. The fundamental postulate perhaps in the massless space is projectivity. In the massive case, the fundamental postulate is not even projectivity. It is just the fact that existence of polytopes. I mean, that's it. That gives us the answer. But there are many, many questions which remain. I'm just listing three which I find interesting. So, you know, if I take a very generic scalar field theory with arbitrary number of scalar fields, phi 1 to phi n, and generic interaction, is there a positive geometry for this this kind of theory? This is an open question, but I think that it's an important question. The other one, which is probably more exciting, is that, you know, as we saw here, for example, that in the case of octahedra in the phi 4 theory, we have to. You know, this equation that I've written here, we have to sum over many Accordia data, because, you know, given a cube in a given dimension, there are more than one Accordia data. But you can ask a different question, that, you know, suppose I give you a polygon geometry, it's one polygon. I don't know, I'm not interested in, I don't know whether I want to fit it to get an amplitude for psi-4 theory with mass spec field, etc. I just give you one polygon geometry. Can it give me amplitude for some theory, let's say a theory with three massive fields, two massive fields, etc. So, you know, rather than looking for getting amplitude for a specific theory, can I ask a question that if I take any polygon geometry in kinematic space, will it give me a amplitude for the theory? Rather remarkably, I'm just saying some very initial stage, some work I'm doing with Brunner, rather remarkably, the answer seems to be an affirmative. But it is very early for me to report something. And another work which is, I feel, important from the perspective of loop amplitude more is that, you know, does it help us in classifying Landau singularity? So one of the big problems we saw was that there were the Fuller thresholds and physical thresholds, and we had no way to distinguish one or the other. Is there a way that the polyhedral geometry can tell us that, you know, all the singularities which intersect the polyhedral are physical, the ones that don't intersect are not physical? And in any kind of super young, already there is a lot of progress in this direction by studying it all. There is something that we are, there's some work in progress run by for non-supervision of fixed. I'm very sorry for going over time, and thanks a lot.
Thank you, Alok.
It's just four of us. Okay. Oh, I didn't. Oh, Sujay is here also. Okay.
Thank you for the nice talk and with all the explanations. If you guys have any question, please ask. Before that, I will suggest everyone, at least two of you, please unmute and give a clap for him for giving such a nice talk. And you can ask.
Thank you.
You can ask questions. Yeah.
Hello.
Hi.
Yeah. So really, for this massless theory, we have this, for the canonical form, we have this projective property, right? We have a, so that property is totally lost.
Yeah. I mean, you know, in the sense that if we say that we care all the Mandelstam variables, invariants, including masses, so M square is like pi dot pi, right? If you say that we scale all of them, then projectivity is still there. But if you say that you want to not scale M square, then projectivity is lost. But you know, the point is that even though the projectivity is lost, the fact that, you know, you have the canonical realization of the associator, and the fact that commutator is also give you the form anyway, so that give you these forms which are, you know, which we don't know whether to interpret them as projectivity or like projective. Or, I mean, this is a question I don't have a very good answer to. It's a very important question, I think, because we want to understand whether this is a projectivity as if this is a fundamental postulate or not. But as you know, that projectivity is seen in super young means and in massless series, but they're all massless. I don't know. We have to think about it a bit more. Like if we ask by scaling all the Mandelstam variables, then it's projective, but otherwise it's not. But it has to be better understood.
Alok, as a follow up to this question, sorry, there's too much feedback. So, the final answer that you get for the canonical form, that's an answer which is living in the projective space, right? So, couldn't you start
in the kinematic space?
Yes. Yeah, I mean that answer would just look like d log x1 3 by x2 4, I think.
So remember kinematic space. Sorry, I should say this a little bit more. So kinematic space, kinematic space as such is still projective in the sense that depends on what we are computing. So if you are computing, so here the one example I gave, the 5-point amplitude, or even if you look at our paper, we were interested in computing the amplitude of all the external particles of massless. So if you take this theory, this, you know, with mixed interaction, 5-1 square, 5-2, 5-1 square, 5-2, and you said I want to compute endpoint amplitude that all the external particles are massless, then the external data has no mass space.
Yes.
No, it has no mass scale. So that is still a projective system as it stands. And even
right,
if
right.
it has external particles are massive, even if your external particles are massive, you can make it. That's what I was trying to like a little bit roundabout that was there. You can make it projective by thinking of a massive particle as coming from like, you know, some of two massless particles. You can always there is a way to make a projective kinematic space even for massive particles. I have to explain a bit more. It can be done, but you know, because I can always think that I introduce, suppose you have p square equal to m square, then I introduce a fiducial momenta p prime and p prime prime, so that p prime plus p prime prime square m square, but p prime is p prime 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 massive. So
yeah.
You know, I think of each massive particle coming from two massless particles colliding in space. So
cool.
In
yeah,
that sense, yeah. We can start with a projective space, and but you know the point is there is a mass scale, so I don't know how to understand this. It's not very clear.
Right, right. No, I was actually thinking about the massless theory only, like for example, in that slide where you had shown, you know, where one of the axes was,
purely massless.
When you had, like, two axes with one of them being x13 and the other being x24. What I was asking is, could you have just had one axis which was x13 by x24, and then think of
you mean that you want a so let me answer this two things. One is that this form is something we are choosing. I mean that's one thing that I want to say, that this is a very general concept. You take a projective space and you take any positive geometry. That is, positive geometry is a geometry which has boundaries of all four dimensions. And in particular, if you take, I did not go into too much technicality, but you can look at, there are specific types of polygeometry which are called simple polytope. So simple polytope is a polytope where the number of boundaries, like n minus one dimensional boundaries adjacent to the vertex, so if you have n dimensional polytope, and look at the boundaries adjacent to any vertex. So the if it's an n dimensional polytope, the number of boundaries adjacent to a vertex is precisely n. So you know, in the case of pentagon, so you know, the, you know, if you look at associated, right, a dumb example, but you see the number of one dimensional boundaries adjacent to any vertex is 2, which is precisely a dimension of the polytope. These class of polytopes are called simple polytopes. Now you take any simple polytope, you put it in projective space, there is a unique form that you can write down in the projective space, which is this form, which in the one-dimensional case looks like this. So you know, that form is just given to you from math consumption.
I see. Okay.
Yeah.
So there's really no choice that you have.
Yeah. I mean, if you start from simple polytope, then you just, because we are just using basic literature. I'm sure there may be some other forms, maybe, you know, one can write down, etc. But I think that some of these are the simplest forms you could have thought of without no other structure to use. Because you know they were available in that way for any simple polytope, but even this form itself won't give you amplitude. I mean, you know, what gives you amplitude is this precise realization, which is what you were asking. Because you see that it's only when the line is 45 degrees, this one, it's only when you have this equation, and you take this form and you restrict it to that line, you get 1 by x1 plus 1 by x2. But if you have a line, if you have the equation which is alpha x1 plus beta x24, for any alpha beta not equal to 1, it will not give you this, so the residue will be big. So that means unitarity.
Right, correct.
So what, I mean, this may be just, I'm just completely speculating, but what Anton was asking about, you know, distributive amplitudes, which means that they are not unitary, then they must, you know, if they ever came from these guys, they must come from realizations which the math guys did not find.
I mean, I guess there you would talk about correlators and not really the amplitude itself, but
that is also true. But if you ask that I want some non-unitary amplitude, then I mean, at a very basic level you say that I want residues not to be one always on a certain level, then you know,
right.
In this case that would mean that we have to look for other levels.
right. Okay. Okay. Cool. And like I understand that at the loop level, the integrand is something which one can generate from this. But has there been any progress made in getting the integrals?
No. Yeah. That is a big difference between the 2π arguments and this case, because you know there it is the integral which has these patterns that people notice and give already geometry. Whereas here, so far it is all for the level of integrand. It's not clear whether, because you know, first of all, these are written for, you know, the integrals established from Maastricht scale, which they will also have higher divergence. And you know, even if they are for massive field, which you can write for single massive, but they have UV divergence, then you have to do this dimensional regularization. But then you know, it becomes very obscure. It's not clear in a dimensional regularization, what is that dimension of kinematic space? How do we view it? So I think there is some. I understand that NEMA has some made remarkable progress in understanding the integral for phi q from the polygon, but I think its paper is not out yet.
Oh, I see. Okay. Okay. Cool.
Okay, I think Alok, thank you.
Okay.
This this will be...
thanks a lot, and thanks for waiting just for us to.
No, I'm trying to help people. I am also learning a lot of things out of this.
Sorry, Sanjan, I can't hear.
Can you be able to hear me again? Hello.
I can hear you. Yeah.
Yes. So.
Yeah. I can hear.
Yeah, actually, this is like, we are all learning from this. So this is, that's why I'm trying to continue for long. It's been a year right now, but like I'm trying to continue because of this thing. I'm not stopping this talk.
Right.
Because it's helping people a lot, because that actually, there are lots of seminars going on, but since there is no time limit, you can speak a lot, you can interact with students, you can ask openly. So that might be very helpful for everyone. So that's why I initially started this thing. Anyways, this will be posted in YouTube. I will share the link and I will chat with you more regarding the issues that I have written to you.
Okay. Thanks.
Stay
okay.
Safe and healthy, everyone. And bye.
Bye.
Bye. Bye. Bye. Bye. Bye. Bye. Bye. Bye.